understanding of how I have thought about it, how I've approached the problem. It's been a frustrating process, to say the least, a process that I think some people in this room may agree has gotten out of control, where, you know, daily newspaper articles have quotes from people and neighbors who have never met me, who have never been to my house, who have never reviewed the plans, who don't know anything about the process, yet seem to have very strong opinions about what I am doing. I noted in the New York Times today John Rich's comments about something about a fight. A fight is the last thing that I want. It is the last thing that I thought I was doing when I embarked on this process. I don't think that kind of commentary in the press is helpful to the process. That's my opinion. Even the motivations of my mother were questioned in a newspaper article the other day, which anyone who knows my art-loving mother would understand how preposterous those comments were. So while I've probably added to people's anxiety by not commenting to the press, as I don't think that that is the proper forum to discuss this issue, I think it was appropriate today to come and explain what I'm doing. Let me start by telling you who I am. Contrary to what you read about in the papers, yes, I am from Connecticut. I live in Connecticut, but I am from Maine, and I am from Cape Elizabeth. I grew up here. I graduated from Cape Elizabeth High School. I went to the State University. My family still lives here. My parents live here. I have cousins here, aunts, uncles, and what have you. While I've had a job that has given me the opportunity to travel and live all over the world, I've always felt that Maine, and particularly Cape Elizabeth, above and beyond all places I've been to, was my home. I know this place, and I understand you people. I understand your issues. I understand why you are concerned. On a cold December day 4 years ago, while looking at the ocean, I came upon the for sale sign at Two Lights, and I felt like the luckiest person in the world. It was one of those decisions, the decision to buy the house, or to try to buy the house, was one of the few decisions that you have in life that was instantaneous. No thought was required. It was a chance to own a home in a place that I love. It was a chance to bring my children here, to impart to them the feeling that I have for this place and what it's meant to me. And I hope that they will pass it down to their children the same way my grandparents passed it down to my parents and the way they have passed it down to me. While lucky, I recognize that this house is special because of what it is, because Hopper memorialized it in his famous paintings, because it was on a stamp, because it's right next to the beautiful tower. The public has a great interest in the property. Being a private property, it requires special consideration of that public interest. Many times, tourists come onto the property with their cameras, with their children, to get a closer look. Photographers have asked to come onto the roof of my property to photograph the light from a different angle. Artists come up there routinely to paint. Art classes come up there to learn. The Cape Elizabeth Historical Society has asked me to work with them to have bus tours come up there to get a closer look. Nobody has ever been denied access over my private property in the time that I've lived there. Just last night at dinner, a photographer crawled out of the bushes, literally came out of the bushes. We thought it was some of our colleagues from the press, and I was worried it was the New York Times, but it turned out just to be another person looking for a closer look. And so while this is a private residence, I have always philosophically believed in providing access because the house is so historically important. In considering changing the house to accommodate the needs that I have, I studied it a lot. I went to the Whitney. I looked at Hopper's paintings. I read Gail Levin's books. I collected old photographs. I read about the history. One thing that jumps out at you very quickly is the house today is not the house that was there 25 years ago. It's not the house that was there 40 years ago. It's not the house that was painted by Hopper. The New York Times picture today makes that very clear. Neither is the land around the house the same as what was memorialized in Hopper's famous paintings. The starkness of that house on that hill was stark because many of my neighbors who are protesting these changes today didn't have their houses built there at that time. So this property has evolved continuously. The additions that were made to it in the late 70s, from an architectural point of view, and I'm not an architectural expert, I've tried to hire an architect who I think is fabulous, who I'd recommend to any of you, who tells me that the additions were very, very, an architectural anomaly, I think, is the word that he would use in terms of the history of the house. And so while, yes, I do want to make some changes to the house, I have studied it as much as anyone and have struggled with it because I, too, wanted to come away with the feeling that what you would all see, the people who look at my home, would come away and said, that guy did something good. That guy tried to be respectful of what the house is and what it means to everybody here. In choosing an architect, I sought someone who was steeped in historical knowledge by way of education and experience. I interviewed a lot of people. After extensive conversations with Steve, I felt that he really got how I was thinking about this. I confirmed my choice in his qualifications with Earl Shuttlesworth, who was the head of the Maine Historical Society, again, with a goal of accomplishing and being respectful of the concerns that you have. After talking extensively to Steve, I gave him four basic operating instructions. One, let's try to bring back the light to something that was more historically appropriate. Let's make it more historically correct. I didn't try to replicate it. That wouldn't work from my perspective. But let's try to make it more of what it was. Two, let's minimize the expansion of the footprint of the building. Three, let's minimize the impact of anyone's view of the house, or of the ocean, or of whatever else you see up there that I see so clearly. and let's minimize the interference with the neighborhood. Those were our objectives. From the first conversations, the famous Hopper painting that was in the paper today was our guide. There's not been one meeting that I've had with Steve Blatt in talking about what we're doing when we asked ourselves, how does this look relative to Hopper? That was the perspective that we've had. I rejected several different proposals because I thought they went too far. I reduced some of the requirements that I have because, again, I thought they impacted the house too much. Much mention has been made about the fact that I'm turning this three-bedroom home into a six-bedroom home, giving the impression that I am somehow pumping the volume of the building way up. Well, let me just make something a little bit clear here. Yes, I am adding one bedroom upstairs. I'm adding two more bedrooms in the basement underneath the house by drilling through ledge so as to minimize the impact on the building on all of you. That is at considerable expense, much more than what I would bear by simply demolishing the structure and starting over. The plan we have now is a good one, I think. It's not perfect. It's not going to satisfy everybody. The other thing I've realized in this process is there are many points of view. There are, on one hand, what I'll just label, not to be pejorative in any way, preservationists who somehow have decided that today we should freeze this property and keep it exactly the way it is, regardless of the fact that it's changed over the years and regardless of the fact that everything around it has changed over the years. And on the other side of it are many of my neighbors who come up to me and say, you know, it's a free country. You should be able to do whatever you want. It's a private residence. You paid for it. You paid a lot of money for it. Anyone else who was concerned about preserving it had the opportunity to buy it, including the town of Cape Elizabeth. The building was designated as a historical building at the time that I purchased it. Anyone had that opportunity. The house sat there for 6 months before I came along and bought it. As I've said to a lot of people involved here, this process is confusing, confusing to me. I've tried to comply with all of the ordinances that the town has laid out, and they're quite clear and quite specific. I know that the infamous 45-day notification period is one that is designed to bring parties together, private parties together, I'm told, to have a discussion. One of the first questions I asked when I filed that notice of the town manager was who? Who do I talk to? And the answer was not specific, only because it couldn't be specific. The who was whoever came forward. I've never been contacted by the Historical Society of Cape Elizabeth. I've read about meetings that were organized to discuss this project in the paper. I read about a letter in the paper that I had supposedly received in the paper, but yet never received it at the time the paper was written. So the process is as confusing for me as I'm sure it is for all of you. What I have consistently said to anybody who has asked, and I'll extend this offer today to everybody in this room, including members of the town council, there's no hidden agenda here. I am happy to have all of you come out there and let me walk you around and show you what I'm trying to do. Let me help you understand the considerations that I faced and the complications that I faced. I think the sort of one-dimensional drawings that you see in the paper, in the Press Herald, are disingenuous to what is really going on. I think what's going on there is a lot, would be a lot more to your approval if you understood it on a three-dimensional basis. And so to any and all of you in whatever format, individually or by group, I extend that invitation. I also want to point out that at the end of whatever this process is, not everyone is going to be satisfied. I'm not totally satisfied with what I have. I would like to do it less expensively. I would like to not incur the expenses that I'm going to incur in order to preserve the views and the image that we all consider to be dear, but I'm willing to do that. And at the end of the day, I hope that the process does not deteriorate into an ongoing one simply because someone didn't get their way. My offer is open to any and all of you. I'll also say that I'll also make the following offer. I know that people are concerned about having some sort of clock ticking in the background while these discussions take place. And so I understand why Councillor Berry introduced this proposal, but I don't think it's necessary for the town to vote on this proposal to pass it. I will unilaterally commit to you that I will not start construction on this for 45 more days, which is meeting you exactly halfway in your request. And I hope you take that offer in the spirit in which it's made. I'll listen to any and all constructive proposals. It's hard to react to comments like, the size is just untenable. I don't know how to deal with that. Okay? You have to hire architects. You have to hire people. You have to bear the expense if you want to be specific. And I'll consider it. And I'll make changes if it works for me, if it's cost effective, and if it is consistent with what I think the historical interpretation is there. So I will make that offer. I hope after bearing with me for these comments, you feel lucky that I'm the guy that bought this house. Because I certainly feel lucky to have it. And I understand the responsibility that comes with it. But if you are concerned about whether or not someone understands it, or whether someone has researched it, or whether someone hasn't tried to put themselves in your shoes, you couldn't be more wrong. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Caracas. Did you want any your architect or anyone else to speak next, or should we just go to the open group? Great, thank you. Okay, in that case, to follow Councilor Reed's suggestion, if people would line up over here behind the podium and follow the outline that I suggested of one, being constructive, two, trying to be concise, and allowing time for people to speak, somebody has to go, in this case, second. Please, when you do, please go up. Yes, and if you would, give us your name, where you live, and obviously present what you'd like to, and others, welcome to line up over there to save a little time in the process. Yes, sir.
Can I go? My name is John Rich. I live in Hanniford Cove, born in Hanniford Cove, and I'm the man that he referred to. Was quoted in the New York Times. That statement that there might be a fight over this thing, and I see you're all here tonight, was made in the wake of a meeting with Mr. Caracas, at which he said he would not delay, he would start demolition September 8th. I am delighted that he's going to give us 45 days. This is what we were after. We are all, I think it's a genuine offer to us, and I think we're most willing to accept that in the hope that he will, through, in cooperation with the council, will work with people who are interested in this to try to work this out amicably. I think we're all not spoiling for a fight. We're anxious to have an amicable settlement of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the council and citizens of Cape Elizabeth. Unlike Mr. Rich and Mr. Caracas, I'm not a lifelong resident of Maine. My family and I moved up here last October. My name is Paul McDonald. My wife and three children moved up here from outside of Philadelphia last October. And we have the distinct privilege of living in the shadow of the Two Lights Lighthouse. And I am reminded every day when I go to bed at night and wake up in the morning of the tremendous beauty and historical significance of that landmark. And in the 11 months that I've lived here, it's become near and dear to my heart. And it's one of the reasons that I have stepped to the fore to become a spokesperson for the citizens concerned for the preservation of the lighthouse. I don't believe that there is anybody more sincere in his desire to protect the integrity of the lighthouse than Bill Caracas. He and I have had a number of conversations over the course of the past weeks and days. And while they haven't always been of a nature where we're able to agree, they have been cordial, they've been productive, and I do believe we're moving forward toward a successful resolution. I, too, am very encouraged by his willingness to voluntarily agree to delay the construction efforts that were set to commence, as we understood them, shortly after Labor Day. But I don't think we're all the way there yet, and I'm very pleased that we are now in a public forum in the presence of the town council, because it's my firm belief that we need the town's assistance and backing in order to reach a successful resolution of this problem. And it's my view that the criteria and the analysis involved here is not as subjective as some might think, but in fact it's really an objective undertaking by the citizens and the council together. And there are several levels on which I think that should be addressed. First, I don't think there's any debate that the lighthouse keeper's house at Two Lights is indeed both a local, state, and a national historic landmark. It's on postage stamps. The image is on Edward Hopper and other paintings that hang in prestigious museums throughout the country. It has received significant local and recently national attention. I don't think we need to debate that that is a piece of property that is of great national, historical, and cultural significance and deserves to be protected. And I think on that score, Bill Caracas and the rest of the community are in agreement. Another area where I do not believe there are issues that are subjective are the town's role in helping to resolve this issue. I am neither an historic preservation nor an architect, and I've not been steeped in knowledge on these issues, but rather have been thrown into the fray over the last week or so. And while I'm still getting up the learning curve, I've done a little bit of research with respect to the town's position on historical preservation, and in particular have looked at issues such as the agendas put forth in the 1993 comprehensive plan. And I would like to just bring to the council's attention what I believe are some important provisions of the plan, which I think impact on how this problem is to be resolved. I refer first to the introduction to the plan, and I'll just read some selected excerpts for the council's consideration. The introduction provides, among other things, it is essential to stress that the adoption of this comprehensive plan necessarily requires a prompt and consistent community response to ensure that its approach and philosophy are effectively carried out. Accordingly, its enactment merely commences a process that must continue throughout the 10-year planning period. The comprehensive plan goes on in what are essentially the guts of the plan to discuss the very issue that we're addressing here today. The policies and recommendations section of the plan provides in its introductory paragraphs. This section of the comprehensive plan delineates a program for the future of the community based upon a comprehensive analysis of all major land use, environmental and demographic data, and upon the views of Cape Elizabeth's residents. It is, in other words, the heart of this plan. To assist the reader, the topics covered in this section and each subsection appear in order of their importance to the town. Although all the issues are important, the document's organizational format permits the reader to appreciate the hierarchy of values espoused by this plan. The goals stated below represent the general policy to be achieved, while the objectives and the recommendations flesh out the issues and steps required to meet each individual goal. The goals, objectives, and recommendations together constitute affirmative policy determinations, which shall, unless further specifically amended, guide the future actions of the town council, all town boards and commissions, and all municipal employees over the next 10 years. Now, the policies and the recommendations section of the comprehensive plan identifies 6 topics, 6 goals, and 32 objectives and recommendations. And as these introductory paragraphs make clear, the hierarchy of importance of those goals, recommendations, and objectives are as they appear in the format of the plan. The first goal of 6 and the 5th objective and recommendation out of 32 states the following: to preserve significant historical and archaeological sites in the town. And the plan goes on to provide there are several historic and archaeological sites in Cape Elizabeth of state and even national significance that should be protected from alteration or demolition, such as the Portland Headlight, Richmond Island, Spurwink Church, and the Two Lights area. The locations of these properties and others are identified in a map set forth in the comprehensive plan. The following steps should be taken over the next few years to afford effective protection to these sites. The recommended implementation step number 1 is to enact performance standards for the subdivision and zoning ordinances that prohibit disturbance of the significant historical and archaeological sites identified herein, listed in the National Register of Historic Places, or determined to be significant by the Maine Historic Preservation Commission, the U.S. Department of Interior, or the Cape Elizabeth Board of Historic Preservation Advisors. Now, the lighthouse keeper's house at Two Lights has been designated by the State of Maine Historic Preservation Commission as a property that is worthy of protection as outlined in the comprehensive plan. The east and west towers of Two Lights have been designated as national landmarks on the National Register of Historic Places. I am suggesting to the Town Council that under the terms of the comprehensive plan, It is the obligation and the duty of the town to step into this arena and to take an active part in an attempt to resolve what, up to this point, has been an attempt by neighbors and property owners and citizens of the town to resolve what is essentially a public dispute. Other municipalities throughout the country and within the state of Maine have taken affirmative steps to enact ordinances that reflect concerns and adopt real procedures to ensure that historic preservation is a goal that is both recognized and achieved. And we are requesting, I am requesting, on the part of other citizens of this community, that the town council begin to take an active role. I believe that during a waiting period that hopefully will be something that comes out of this meeting by agreement rather than resolution of the town council, that the dialogue can indeed begin. It has been ongoing between Bill Caracas, myself, and other people. And while we're trying and we're making progress, we haven't made much headway on the ultimate issues, which are, what is that house going to look like when the renovation is over? My suggestion, and I think the suggestion of other people, would be to let some experts get involved. I know that certain organizations have sent letters to various members of the council suggesting that a group of experts be selected or retained by the town to work in conjunction with Mr. Caracas and his representatives to see if a compromise can be reached. And I would endorse that policy and request that the town consider it very seriously, because Bill is right. No plan is ever going to be enacted that's going to satisfy everybody. But I think if we are all reasonable people and enter into this in a true spirit of compromise and cooperation, that the best course of action is to let the experts take a look at the problem and let the experts make the decisions as to what level of renovation is appropriate, and that we as a town ought to be satisfied to live with the decision of the people who know best. Lastly, I would close with saying that I don't think that that problem is as significant as some may think it's going to be, because based on the research that I've done over the past days and weeks, I don't think it's a question of style. I don't think it's a question of design. I think that the resolution of what that house is going to look like after these changes are made, and I'm accepting the fact that changes should be made and can be made, but I think that the criteria to be applied are not subjective. They are objective. What we have learned from people who are experienced in this area is that there are standards that have been promulgated by the Secretary of the Interior, which are known as the Standards for Treatment of Historic Properties. They are objective criteria that govern the rehabilitation of historic properties owned by the federal government and those subject to various state and local ordinances in areas other than Cape Elizabeth. And we believe that those are the principles that can and should guide the renovation of the Lightkeeper's House, and that it is experts in the field who have the wisdom, the knowledge, and the experience to apply those guidelines to the Lightkeeper's House. And my suggestion would be that to the extent they can and are followed, that the town ought to be, because I certainly would be willing, once those guidelines are applied to the situation, to live with whatever it is that Bill Caracas decides to do with his home. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Jack?
I'll tell you up forward now, I'm not going to try to be as articulate as my friend here, the lawyer, Paul McDonald, who's a neighbor of mine. I'm here really in defense. I'm here really in defense of fairness. Okay. I don't know.
Jack, could you just say who you are, please? I don't know.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought everybody knew who I was. I talk so much. Jack Beaton. And I live on Two Lights Terrace. And I have lived there for 15 years. And when I moved there, I had an absolute clear view of that house up there, okay? I don't anymore, and I never complained once, because they've built beautiful homes up there, and they are beautiful homes. And I'm sure when Mr. Crocus gets through, there's going to be one more beautiful home. And I don't think he should. I tell you, he's more than fair when he accepts another 45 days hold up on this thing. Because I spoke, and Mr. Berry was there last Thursday night, and I asked the questions, the obvious ones, about the man's deed, whether there was anything in it. He bought the home. Was there anything in that deed that would prevent him from doing anything that he isn't already trying to do? And nobody can answer the question. So whether that's changed or not, I don't know. And I tell you, this number keeps coming up all the time, and I can't quite understand it. All these people that are objecting to it. Now, I know John very well. He's a good friend of mine, okay? And he's objecting to it, and I can't find any fault with John. Who the rest of them are, I don't know. I tell you, if anybody lived up there on that terrace for a decade or two decades, might have some strong feelings. But I can't even find them. They're not even this group. Except a few of them. No, don't get me wrong, folks. I know who you are, but I'm saying numbers. They're not here. So there's something awfully wrong, I'll tell you right now. I don't know who is objecting to this, but it's not the neighbors. We got some beautiful homes up there, and they range anywhere from who knows what up to $1 million. And as far as I'm concerned, it's the finest neighborhood in Cape Elizabeth, okay? Bar none. Now, if anybody wants to take offense to that, fine. As long as you don't do it with gloves on. But anyhow, I feel that way very, very strongly. And I wish Mr. Crocus all the luck in the world of going through with his plans and putting another beautiful place up on that hill. Because that always hasn't been that beautiful, and I agree with him. I can remember it was a mess, an absolute mess, ready to fall down. But now it's halfway decent. It's going to stand an awful lot of improvement. And you know, historical places, that's just fine. But I'll tell you something right now, folks. I'm a 3/4 century old, and I'm not bragging about that. So I probably won't be in that street another 50 years. I don't believe. But I'll tell you something. As long as I'm there, all I want to see in that neighborhood is improvement. And I think this is one hell of a big stride towards that. No, I'm not going to say any more. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Good evening. My name is Bob Gilbertson. I live at 8 Lighthouse Point Road, underneath the lighthouse in the Two Lights area. We've lived there for about 22 years, and we are visual abutters to the keeper's house. We are not actual abutters. I had the pleasure a few days ago of taking a tour of the keeper's house with Paul McDonald and John, and Bill Caracas showed us his plans for the house, for the land, and where he was going to site the changes. And I came away very impressed with Bill's sincerity, the research that he's done, and the commitment that he's made to maintain the keeper's house in its historical mode to the ultimate extent that he could and still make it a livable home for himself and his family. What concerns me now is that we are dealing in areas of design which are a matter of taste and a matter of opinion, and that at the end of the day, somebody's going to have to make a decision as to which way we go. And even though we have people of good faith negotiating on both sides of the table, I'm sure in the final analysis that there is going to be compromises have to be made on both sides. And my plea here is that the property rights of the owner of the property have got to be recognized. He bought the property in good faith, and he should be able to, within reason, use the property in the best and highest use as he sees it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Others?
Well, looks like I'll be it. Hi, I'm John Schlett with my wife, Andalina. She'll stand beside me here. Live on Balsam Road, corner of Lighthouse Point. We've lived there about a year ourselves. And I'll make it brief. I just wanted to say that, above all, I want to echo what Jack Beaton said, and I want you to take a look at the fairness of what you're asking Mr. Caracas to do. I feel, and I have gone up there and taken the opportunity to speak with Mr. Caracas, to look at the plans and then listen to him here tonight. And even though my view, and that's a view that I have that I walked into and I just thought was beautiful, and I realize that will change, but above all, I respect his property rights and the needs of what he needs for himself and his family. And above all, it is on a lot of registers. It is a famous, it's in many historic publications, and there's a lot of artwork associated with the property. But above all, it is a private residence. And anything you consider here tonight, I'd like you to take into account the fact that it is a private residence and to look at the fairness of what you're asking Mr. Caracas to do. I am satisfied as a homeowner in the area that he has taken into account my interests, the interests of my neighbors, and of you folks here tonight and the folks here in the audience. I'm satisfied. And I wanted to point that out, that I am a neighbor.
Thank you. Are there other people who would like to speak? Yes, please come up.
My name is Hillary Egan, and I'm a resident of Hanford Cove Road. And I am interested in this project. I've become more involved in the project because we got our names in the paper. And I just want to share with this room that my phone and my fax have been buzzing and ringing all day with people's concern from all over the country. This morning I woke up to a telephone call from San Francisco, California, and a Nobel laureate physicist called me to said, I just read about this in the New York Times. I'm concerned about it. I come to Maine every other summer. This is an important piece of architectural history. Do what you can to make sure that the town cherishes it and handles the renovation of it sensibly. That went on in that kind of attitude throughout the day, and just when I thought it was settling down, a young man from Arlington, Virginia called and said that he had been inspired to write a poem this afternoon, and he wanted to send it to me, but he didn't have a fax machine. If he drove out and found a place to fax it, could I get it to the meeting in time? So not to dwell on the issue that this is not just a town thing, I think as town council members and citizens of Cape Elizabeth, we're surrounded by natural beauty, and in Maine, we're surrounded by lighthouses with historical significance. And that is not to begin to treat them as commonplace and forget that we have as a responsibility to preserve what we can that's historically significant, not just for our children and for our town, but because people on the national level care about these treasures. I too am heartened that Mr. Caracas is feeling flexible about demolition dates, which is what we've been hearing about in the newspaper, and perhaps there is a group of people who can come to a point of agreement. But thank you for the town council for assuming the responsibility charged to you in the comprehensive plan to aggressively protect historic points in the town of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
My name is Eileen Calico, and I too am a resident of Hanford Cove Road, and I think my neighbor has taken away three quarters of what I would like to say. But I fully appreciate what you have articulated as your goals and your desire to achieve. I also fully appreciate how beautifully the design has been articulated by Mr. Blatt, and at the same time want to say that as a 20-year resident of Cape Elizabeth and as a person who's come to speak before you about similar kinds of issues in terms of the comprehensive plan and putting it into place and into action rather than just into words, that I am sad for you that you are put in the middle of the fact that we as residents of Cape Elizabeth, in fact, 4 years ago, didn't buy this property. And I'm sad for us that we come up here and are sort of after trying to close the barn door after the horses escape. And I ask you as our counselors to please consider the fact that yes, you're put in an untenable position to make a choice between a person's property rights and the rights of all citizens, I believe, that are residents of Cape Elizabeth and also of this nation, who appreciate and honor what we take for granted and don't always pay attention to. And I'm asking you as the town council to please make some decisions, put into place some ordinances and regulations that articulate what we have all agreed and accepted is our comprehensive plan. And again, I, you know, my hat's off to, you know, the owner, to other neighbors. All of us would like a successful resolution of this. And at the same time, we'd like our officials to start, at least now, to put into place processes, procedures, rules, regulations, so that we're not here in a crisis mode the next time. Thank you.
Thank you. Other speakers, please come on up and form the line if you want to speak. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. My name is Ariette McDonald. I am Paul McDonald's wife, who spoke earlier. And as Paul mentioned, we are new to Maine and to Cape Elizabeth. I have begun to clearly understand that in Cape Elizabeth over the years, there's been much discussion about the rights of private property owners versus historic preservation, and that this has been an ongoing dialogue for many years. Just to give you a little bit of my firsthand knowledge, we moved here from a small town in New Jersey called Haddonfield. It was a Quaker town founded in the 1600s, and much of the town has much historic significance. Much of the town, probably more than 95%, is privately owned, and much of the town is protected by historic preservation ordinances. Yes, there are people in the town of Haddonfield who can't paint their houses unless they get approval of the color. These are steps that are common in towns who wish to preserve the historic resources that enrich the community, that are the heart and soul of the community. Since becoming part of this project, I have learned that the acquisition of Fort Williams almost didn't happen. I have learned that the preservation of Portland Headlight almost didn't happen. I, on a regular basis, enjoy Fort Williams, Portland Headlight. I, and I'm sure all of you on a regular basis, enjoy the old port in Portland. Can any of us imagine our community without these historic landmarks and without the richness that comes into our lives because of them, that we share with people worldwide? You know, I think that there is a true, sincere motivation on Bill Caracas's part to respect history and attempt to work within a historical context. However, the most widely applied standards in the country for historic preservation are the U.S. Secretary of the Interior's. Bill Caracas's project would fall under the category of rehabilitation. It is a category where the homeowner is allowed to add to a property, to make changes, and to fine-tune the property to their needs, inside and out. But it also imposes general guidelines for doing this that clearly his plans to date are in violation of. So it's not black and it's not white. People, I don't know that anybody is saying that he can't touch a shingle or a brick or floorboard. He does fall into a very acceptable category of rehabilitation, and there are very helpful, productive guidelines that he can be applying to his project. And because of the comprehensive plan, I would ask that the council work with him to help implement some of those guidelines. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Tony Kostopoulos, and I live at 28 Broad Cove Road. Bill Caracas is my nephew. I probably already know that. Probably for a character reference, Bill, when he bought the house, never made mention of destroying it in any which way. He just wanted to make it better for the community and for the neighbors. Now, I give him all the credit in the world to be as patient as he has been, or as willing to be patient, being a businessman and owning property in Cape Elizabeth or anywhere, willing to work with the neighbors or the or whatever committee can, he's willing to work with almost anybody. And I find that, to me, that's is a good character reference right there. Bill has never tried to hide what he wants to do to the house. He's opening the doors to almost everybody, including the whole council. And I think he's going to do a good job of whatever he has to do with it. And keep in mind, he is a native of Cape Elizabeth. And I've been here for 30 years, and I've seen this town go from 4,000 people to almost 10,000. And I've seen palatial mansions built everywhere, all around me in Broad Cove. And to see him come up with a plan to try to stay within the beauty of the home, I think it's commendable on his part. Thank you.
Sure, but you have to come to the mic, and why don't you follow her, because she was up to the mic before you. Come on up. Okay, that's fine. Thank you. Yep, please give your name and address.
Nice, sir.
Oh, that's all right. You'll get a chance then.
My question is, where is Mr. Caracas a resident?
Well, I think what I had said before, and I'd like to stay with that, is that we'll leave questions till later, and you're certainly welcome to ask him
okay.
what, but I'd like to avoid anything that becomes at all controversial and contesting among people. And so I carefully left the questions to the end, and I'd like to have the council be able to ask questions of the speakers, yeah. and I'm sure that Mr. Caracas would be happy to answer your question in a less public forum.
Uh-huh. I just asked that in relation to the last statement that was made.
That's fine.
Well, I have a statement from the president of the Maine College of Art. I spoke to him yesterday. He's out of town, but he was willing to have his support given in relation to what we thought at the time was to get an extension of time, which we now have, but at that time it was for 90 days. According to the New York Times, Edward Hopper's vision of our two lights, like housekeeper's home, was prophetic. This certainly has been proven by the hundreds of artists who have painted this scene. Roger Gilmore said that while he couldn't be here, he would like to lend his support for requesting a 90-day delay in Mr. Caracas's plan, and he said he would give this would give more time for considerations. He specifically authorized me to deliver this statement this evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes,
for the record, that was Mrs. Deely Rich. I believe the name wasn't.
Oh, heard. Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't notice that. Yes, ma'am, would you please say who you are, where you live, and go to it.
Okay, my name is Marion Shepherd. I live on Sebago Lake, in Standish, Maine. My grandfather, Captain Frank L. Cotton, was keeper at the Two Lights from 1909 until 1926 when he retired due to ill health. I spent the summer there in the keeper's house in 1925. I have a question. Does the town own Richmond's Island?
No.
No.
Okay. The town does own Portland Head. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The town does own Spurwink Church. Yes.
Yes? Yes.
But the town missed its opportunity when the Coast Guard abandoned that building and it nearly fell down. The town should have taken it. When it came up for sale in 95, I even counted all my monies, hoping I could come up with $450,000. I couldn't. I couldn't buy it when the town abandoned it. I had three small children, and I couldn't buy it. But I would like to offer an alternative. Could we not form a nonprofit organization like Friends of Two Lights or Lighthouse Foundation and buy this property from Mr. Caracas for $500,000 and restore it to its original shape and then rent it by the week to a couple for a working vacation, no dogs, no cats, no birds, no fish.
Don't worry.
They would mow the lawn, they would scrape paint, they would paint when necessary. This would keep it in its original condition, and Mr. Caracas would be able to find a house that would provide more leisure-type living that we are accustomed to. When this house was built in 1873, they didn't know much about leisure living. The rooms are very small, it's poorly designed, it isn't meant for modern day living. So perhaps as an alternative, something like that could be accomplished and Mr. Caracas could find a place on the water with a spectacular view that's more in keeping with the modern living. Thank you.
Thank you for speaking and for coming. Are there other people?
Good evening, Council. And Mr. Caracas, I'm happy to see you.
Please.
My name is Louise Sullivan. I live at Journey's End on Two Lights Road. Which is also a historic property. So I'm going to tell you a story about my house a little bit. We moved to Journey's End about 12 years ago from the Shore Road, sort of fleeing development. And I was thrilled to find this old farm and found it and bought it in the same way that you found the lighthouse. I mean, there it was and boom, you know, I just fell in love. But the house needed a ton of work. And so when we moved in, we started that work. We started all these renovations. We had a new roof and new electricity, and oh my goodness sakes, just went to town. And it was really overgrown in the front. And so I got out there with my saw and my husband and his chainsaw, and we started to work on the mulberry tree that sits in the front yard. Now, you know, there were workmen all over the house, putting on new roofs and inside doing new electricity and things like that. But when we got out in the front yard with the chainsaw, cars stopped. And people started coming out of their cars and saying, "You're not going to cut that down. You're not going to cut that down, are you?" And all of a sudden I got it that this house that I was thinking of is my house and it needed that mulberry tree trimmed at least, but probably down and a little something cute in the front like that. This house was my house, but it was also other people's house as well. And I'm so glad people stopped that day. I'm so glad that people stopped and that I came to that understanding. The house, you know, has changed over the years and has changed inside, but we have photographs and very old plates, daguerreotype plates, is that what they're called? Those kind of picture making that's not a photograph, you know, that show the structure essentially unchanged from the late 1800s. And I understand that living in my house can be inconvenient, but that the house belongs to us, the Sullivans, but it also belongs to the town of Cape Elizabeth and our sense of the past. And I hold it as a treasure. I know the dilemma that you feel, and I sympathize with it. And I salute your willingness to listen to your neighbors and listen to townspeople. I hope that you find a happy resolution. I hope you have many happy years there. And I hope that you have the opportunity sometime to hear stories from people like Mrs. Cotton, who can tell you what happened in every single one of those rooms, as we have from Julia Woods McIntyre and other people who've lived at Journey's End. So, thanks. Good luck. Thank you. And I hope that our town will think not only of preserving historic properties, but really, when they're coming up, think of some way, can we afford to own them so that people don't get into these terrific binds that Mr. Caracas finds himself in now. Thanks.
Thank you. Are there other speakers? Last chance. Oh, that always scares up somebody. That's good.
My name is Ralph Romano. I live across the street at 12 Two Lights Terrace. I've lived there for 25 years. I looked at the plans that we saw in the paper. It looked beautiful. You know, I mean, it looked like it was a wonderful house. And you know, I certainly have no problem with somebody, you know, building a house on their property, you know, whatever they want. However, the more I thought about it, you know, I thought that you can build a house that you need. I mean, you can build 6 bedrooms, 10 bedrooms on probably any other lot in Cape Elizabeth. And I don't think anybody would care. It'd be between you and the building inspector. I mean, you wouldn't get all these people down here about it. That house does have some other baggage that goes along with it. And you know that because, I mean, you lived in Cape Elizabeth. You realize what it is, and you're very sensitive to it. The other thing that that doesn't really square in my mind is if you're so sensitive to how the other people feel about this house, why would you want to change it? I mean, I would have a hard time. If I had all the legal rights and no one could stop me, but this many people, I mean, there are a lot of people here, I don't know. I mean, they can't all be supporters. But I don't know how bad I feel about it. I mean, if you do that over there, you raise the value of my house. I hate to say that in front of somebody that's a good friend of the tax assessor, but that would, you know, I mean, you're doing a favor that way in the neighborhood. But I could not, knowing as many people, not only in the town or in the neighborhood, the state, but the thousands, the literally thousands of people that come up there. Well, that's no exaggeration, too, because I've seen them in snowstorms in the middle of the winter come up, you know, to take a look. It's amazing. But those people care about it. And I don't know how someone could change that, you know, especially when you can build a house that you want to. You know, you can find another place, you know, another house, and everybody's happy. Another lot, you know, right? I mean, there are thousands of them in Cape Elizabeth. No one would care. Everyone would wish you well.
I think your spot's very attractive.
If you got the money, buddy, you come right over anytime.
Okay, let's stay on this presentation.
Yeah.
Okay.
But no, I'm serious. I am serious. I mean, I say that half in jest. I mean, there are some of the neighbors that have lived there, and You know, they might be making other plans in the area. I'd be happy to have them as a neighbor. I mean, I have no problem with that. Happy to have them build a house. But why does it have to be right there in that spot? I mean, is that the only place in the area? You have to ask yourself that question. You know, that's not the last lot in Cape Elizabeth or the last place anybody's ever going to build a house. So I don't know. I mean, I'm kind of ambivalent about it, I guess. I'm glad it's your decision, not mine. But, thank you.
Thank you. Other people? Sir? There's one in the back coming up.
My name is Frank Latore, and I live in Cape Elizabeth, and I have the proud honor of having served on the town council, a distinct pleasure that I had for 6 years, I might say, and I enjoyed every minute of it. And I know what you're going through on a night like this. It's a night of angst. It's also a night of kind of why you all decided to run and get elected. We have to make the tough decisions. We have to step forward, and I think it's important. And as a former counselor, I guess a perspective I can give, you know, I want to say that I'm glad to hear about the self-imposed 45-day moratorium that has come forward tonight. I think that's a wonderful step forward. And you as counselors may be thinking, what can we do? You know, because the key thing to me that I'm thinking about while sitting here is what's going to happen over the next 45 days? I've been in politics for a long time. A lot of words have been said here, but the rubber's going to hit the road at some point. What's going to happen over the next 45 days? And I just want to remind you, I think you've got two obligations here. One is to listen to the sentiment of those that elected you. And there's a sentiment that there's a number of us that simply don't want to see, any renovation there that we would consider inappropriate. And I think that's a key word. And I think it's a word that we're going to have to be talking about over the next 45 days. What's appropriate within certain guidelines? What's inappropriate? There's also an obligation which I think is an overarching one, which is to support the comprehensive plan. It is incredibly important that elected officials, with all the work and time that went into that document, put some teeth behind it. So I think we're kind of looking to you, and I would just come up, and the reason that I decided to come up was just to urge you, have some part in what goes on over the next 45 days. I don't think it should be just simply by private parties alone negotiating. There may be a discrepancy. There may be just simply at the end of the day not an agreement. I'd like to see the town take an active role. I think you mentioned the word earlier, creative. What creative sources can you come up? Can you be a mediator? Can you, believe me, I'm not of the us versus them mentality. Those days are gone. We want to work on this all together. You have property rights, but we have rights of protection as well to watch out for that word inappropriate. So I really ask you as elected officials, kind of go into your heart and soul a little bit and say, what can we do? Many of us put a lot of time and thought into that comprehensive plan. And now this is the time that we have to step forward and say, this is what we stand for as Cape Elizabeth citizens, and we as your elected officials will play some active role. And I need someone to represent me. I don't have the time to enter into these discussions myself, and I'm looking to my town for help on this. So again, it's not a black and white, it's a gray area, but think of that word. It's what this is about is appropriate renovations, appropriate to a national treasure. So please, I ask you to think about, get together amongst yourselves and say, what can we do? We appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Other folks? Yes. One more time, please.
These are John Rich again. These are faxes that reached me on the way to you. I think every member of the council has a copy, but the people here, I think tonight, should know what has arrived late this afternoon. It was sent to me because they thought things were shut down here after 4 o'clock. One fax comes from the National Trust for Historic Preservation and the other for the Maine Preservation Association. I think they may be very helpful as you go forward, as we go forward during this next 45 days, trying to get an amicable settlement of this situation. The first from the National Trust for Historic Preservation, addressed to Henry Beyer, and so forth. I'll move along. This has come to my attention. This is signed by Wendy Nicholas, director of the National Trust. It has come to my attention that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council will be meeting tonight to review the town's alteration / demolition notification policy for historic structures. I understand that this review has been prompted by a proposal to build an addition to the Keeper's Cottage of Two Lights Lighthouse. The National Trust for Historic Preservation is a congressionally chartered nonprofit organization whose mission is to provide leadership, education, and advocacy to save America's diverse historic places and revitalize our communities. The National Trust is a membership organization with over 275,000 members nationwide. The Northeast Regional Office of the National Trust represents programs of the National Trust to the six New England states, New York, Pennsylvania, Delaware, and New Jersey. Two Lights Lighthouse and its Keeper's Cottage are landmarks of national significance, representing an authentic vestige of Maine's important maritime heritage and an icon of American art through Edward Hopper's painting. The lighthouses of Maine are renowned across the country, and remarkable efforts to preserve these structures throughout the state have already been taken place. We urge the town of Cape Elizabeth to follow in this tradition and work to identify a solution that meets the current owner's needs while preserving the historic, character-defining features of the Keeper's Cottage. We also urge the town to explore the possibility of implementing a local historic preservation ordinance. Such a tool would allow the community to better protect Cape Elizabeth's historic resources and create a valuable system for public input on proposed changes to them. Communities throughout the state have successfully used these ordinances to preserve their unique character and important landmarks. Our office is available to assist you in exploring this and other helpful historic preservation planning opportunities. Please do not hesitate to contact me with any questions. Wendy Nichols, Director. There's another offer of assistance and also concern. Maine Preservation in Portland has written you, signed by Roxanne Eflin, the Executive Director. Dear Town Council members, Maine Preservation has been asked to write in support of concerned citizen efforts seeking local legislation specifically to protect the historic integrity of the Keeper's House at the famous Cape Elizabeth Light. Undisputably, this irreplaceable architectural treasure of Maine's past has significance far greater than the local community. This symbol of coastal New England is recognized nationally and deserves your most serious and immediate attention. The vast majority of Maine's significant historic buildings are privately owned, protected against unsympathetic alteration or demolition via local protective measures through comprehensive planning and zoning regulations. In light of the combined development pressures and subsequent threats to historic resources in Cape Elizabeth, we strongly urge, and this is underlined, we strongly urge you to formally adopt a thorough historic preservation ordinance and revise the current 45-day demolition delay provisions. In lieu of the property owner's agreeing to modify his proposed remodeling plans, bracket, and perhaps accepting a preservation casement and complying with the widely accepted, quote, Secretary of the Interior Standards for the Treatment of Historic Properties, unquote, the fate of this historic property is up to the elected officials of Cape Elizabeth. The architectural elevations recently published in the Portland Press Herald indicate a large addition that will, in our opinion, irreversibly and unsympathetically alter the historic form of the Keeper's House. We ask that you help prevent this mistake from happening by allowing time for negotiation to occur between the architect slash owner and a select, quote, think tank of professional preservationists. Thank you for your consideration and for being a partner in preserving one of your, and indeed our, most important historic landmarks. I think we signed Roxanne Elfin, Executive Director. I think these are two offers of help, which as we go forward in this 45-day period, which has been very genuinely offered to us by the owner, these people can be brought in and could be most helpful to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rich. Is there anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, good evening. I'm Marian Romano. Good evening, Mr. Caracas. I feel like I'm the keeper of your house many days. I live near his house, and probably when I go out to do my yard work, as I have, everybody's quoting how many years they've been here, so I guess I will, 25 years. Everyone wants to know if they can go up, and they ask me. And I feel like it's hard. It's really hard. So if you have any privacy, it's because I try to say no, okay? And there are private signs, private drive, but still probably, no exaggeration, if I'm out mowing the lawn, I get 10 people in that duration sometimes. Even my painter that's working on the house getting $25 an hour is being asked this morning all these questions, and I'm like, go away, go away. But I think the thing is, if people decide that they want to make this the public place, they have to make up their mind. This is a private neighborhood, and basically, we get a lot of tourists, and that's great. You know, that's really great. But I'm getting really tired of being the police person for Two Lights Terrace. Am I to say now, oh, go ahead up? Or what does the town, how does the town feel like that? If, you know, we have, you talk about Harper's View, who can see it? What public person can go see Harper's View, really? When people come into my driveway, am I supposed to say, oh yes, this is our landmark, go right ahead? But it isn't, it belongs to him. It's his, the lighthouse may belong to the government, but it's his house. And I really would like to know as a citizen, you know, I feel like the police person, what advice would, you know, it would be awful if he had that 10 more people coming up every day. I'm sure he probably wouldn't want to live there anymore. The tourists are very nice. They're always very polite. I've never met a tourist I didn't like. They are really sweet, very polite. And I just think that this is an ongoing thing. I don't know if other people appreciate the activity at the end of the street, which we never complain about. I don't mind. I really don't mind. But the only thing I do mind is being in a position of saying, you know, may I go up to the lighthouse, maybe what? I feel like I have to say no. And then sometimes, you know, I have to go into a great explanation. So I don't know I don't know what else you could have put up for a sign or a gate or something. So I don't have
to. There are two sides of it.
Right.
On the right hand and say.
Yeah. But I think that's another issue, too. When you're talking about this being a public place or restoring something, and you have to realize, where do you go? Even if it were possible to purchase the property, which I would think would be doubtful, how is the town going to treat that with the zoning? This is private land. This isn't something that people are going to be able to just come and open up. Can you open up a museum there? I don't think so. But I think maybe it's something that I need to work out with Mr. Caracas. But I mean, it really is an issue. You're talking about this is a public place, and really it's not a public place. And you know, even if the town were to make it so, I think it's zoned against having it be such. So I don't know how that works into your scheme of thinking about zoning and that sort of thing, that, you know, what do you do to make it become, if the town were to somehow or other be in control of that house, how would you approach that? So I would be careful, because I think I'm going to quit my job as the keeper. So thank you.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Council, my name is Ken Lane. I live at 5 Beacon Lane at Two Lights. I'm also the owner of the West Beacon. I have a very great concern of historic preservation. The thing that concerns me tonight is there's a well-developed body of practice with regard to historic properties that are not being applied in Cape Elizabeth, and that we do not have in place the right structure. That should be the town's first business going forward. So I experienced that firsthand in that the more I tried to repair and restore the lighthouse, the higher my taxes on that property were raised. And in discussing that with the tax assessor, I was told, well, if you don't like it, go ahead and tear it down. It's your lighthouse. So I really think the town needs to focus on, you know, where they are and take advantage of all the great work that's been done. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, seeing none, before we get to the, yes, sir?
The idea has come up, my name is Ralph Romano. The idea has come up a couple of times that maybe the town might assume ownership of it. And I think that's, I don't know, if anybody that thinks that that's a good idea should go over to Fort Williams and take a look at the Goddard Mansion that was under the town's care. And the town let it go to pieces, and I think eventually they torched it for what was left of it. So they ought to keep that in mind before anybody has any ideas of the town owning it. I think it's the worst possible solution. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, at this point in time, I'd like to move toward the councilor's questions. Before that, though, I think it's appropriate. I think at least, Councilor Berry, did you have a couple of other things that were to be read into the record?
Oh, yeah. There's a letter addressed to you, Mr. Chairman, that Thomas Egan, who lives on Hannaford Cove Road, had to go out of town on business and asked me to read into the record a letter addressed to you.
Please do.
So I'll read that. Mr. Henry G. Beyer, Chairman, Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Dear Mr. Beyer, I have asked Henry Berry as my neighborhood representative to read this letter into the record of the proceedings of the town council as it considers an emergency ordinance to protect historic properties in the town. The immediate cause of your meeting tonight is well known, having become the subject of news reports, editorials, and civic action. Of course, I am speaking of the proposed impending demolition and dramatic architectural changes to the Keeper's House at Two Lights. Others tonight will review a history of sufficient efforts by the previous councils. Others tonight will review a history of insufficient efforts by previous councils to protect and preserve historic places and views in the town. You will hear sentiments that the Keeper's House and Light Tower at Two Lights are living symbols of our maritime and cultural heritage, that they define our neighborhood, indeed our town and state, in a most eloquent way. Eloquent. Like the editorial in the Press Herald, you will hear that it will be a great shame to our town and to us as individuals if we do not do everything in our power to preserve the house for the generations to come. Indeed, the comprehensive plan charges you to aggressively protect important community values, on page one. Instead of repeating what others will say or addressing the mechanics of passing a necessary, effective emergency ordinance to protect recognized historic landmarks in town, I'm going to tell you what this issue means to me. I do so not because of ego, but because, in my words, you and others may find communion and support for action. The light of the sun playing on the tower and the house together is a beauty no painting can ever portray. When the fog lifts to expose them, or when the moon bathes them in its light, I am comforted. When the six crystal beams pierced the darkness on the road or through the window in my son's bedroom, we counted to six and established a connection to every mariner or thoughtful person who ever did the same. Now that there is only an anemic airline beacon in the tower, I grasp to share the vision of the tower and house which Hopper saw, and with so many others today and in the future, to feel like he did about Two Lights. There is nothing so perfectly symbolic of my connection to the environment or culture here in Maine than these two elements of living history. When I look at Two Lights, I know this is where I belong. I hope you can do something to keep it that way. Thank you, Thomas M. Egan.
Thank you. Okay, questions? Councilor Reed.
May we take a 10-minute break?
Let's limit it to three, if that's all right. All right, we'll take a 3-minute break, folks.
by the way, girls need fun.
Okay, everyone, let us please recommence.
Excuse me.
I think we are at the stage wherein the counselors were going to ask questions of the presenters if they had any questions, and I don't know if that's the case or not. Are there questions? Councilor Goff.
Mr. Chairman, I don't have a question, but I would like to thank everybody tonight for their input. I would especially like to thank you, Mr. Crockett, because I think you have made the town council's, in my view, the town council's job here tonight much, much, much easier by voluntarily agreeing for a 45-day period in which dialogue can take place among all interested parties. From my point of view, it is an inappropriate forum tonight for the town council to commit in a public session without a workshop, just off the top of our heads, what role, if any, the town council should have in this 45-day period. And I would ask my fellow town councilors to join with me in affirmatively and with deep thanks accepting your proposal to basically stay things for 45 days. And I would ask my fellow town councilors to join with me that are very at the earliest opportunity to have a town council workshop that can be on a much more informal basis, that we can really discuss some ideas to decide what, if any, role the town council will have in this 45-day period. That's what I'm proposing. I'm hoping my fellow town councilors support what I'm suggesting happen, and we not have further discussion tonight that I think could do nothing but perhaps alienate individuals rather than help bring them together. And I think this is a time where we should be working together, not trying to pick sides. And while we should be talking on a much more informal basis about what role, if any, we should have, and we can better accomplish that in a workshop. Thank you.
Is that in the form of a motion?
That is in the form of a motion, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second that.
Seconded by Councilor Reed. Discussion. Yes.
I'm just wondering if that motion is in the form of what we have in front of us with the 45-day period inserted.
No, that motion is to graciously accept Mr. Caracas's offer to unilaterally not do anything for the next 45 days. And although we've all had experience lately that some of we can't always depend on people's word, and some people obviously in public life aren't always telling the truth, I still have an amazing amount of respect for the word of Cape Elizabeth residents and people that come and make promises at our town meetings. And I have absolutely no doubt whatsoever that if Mr. Caracas stood up and unilaterally offered to basically have a 45-day standstill period, that's exactly what we have, and I do not believe it's necessary to pass any type of formal moratorium, and that's why my motion specifically did not call for one. It called for graciously accepting Mr. Caracas's offer.
Other questions? Yes, Councilman.
That's with the understanding that we will get together and discuss amongst ourselves at a workshop what input, if any, we should have. We do that as soon as possible, so if we do decide as a council that we need to get involved in some form or fashion, that we have time within that 45 days
to be an active
participant.
Absolutely, and I, speaking for myself, am willing to do that within a seven-day period. I left it as expeditiously as possible because every time I've ever used those words with this council, it's happened within 7 days, and that's fully my, that's how I anticipate things would happen. Okay.
Other questions? Yes, Councilor Reed.
Just a comment. In light of the fact that hopefully the scheduled meeting that we had tonight will be postponed to that time as well, we certainly have motivation to do it. I seconded the motion, fully understanding Mr. Groff's intent, and I move the question.
Thank you very much. It's been moved and seconded and moved that we move to the question. Therefore, let us do a roll call just to make this as formal as we need to. Everyone understands the proposal that Councilor Goff made. Okay, all the ayes and the nays, please.
Councilor Berry?
I think that satisfies each side's request for an extension. I'll vote yes.
Counselor Fritz?
Yes, I hope that Mr. Caracas does realize the seriousness of I mean, we're not adopting the ordinance, but, or I mean, a proposal that was before us for a moratorium, but I think we're serious about getting together on the issue.
Counselor Groff?
Yes, for the reasons previously stated.
Counselor McGinty?
Yes.
Counselor Reed?
Yes.
Counselor Watson?
Yes.
Chairman Beyer?
Yes.
Motion carries, 7 yeas.
Great, thank you. There's nothing else on the formal agenda tonight? Oh, there is. Counselor Reed?
I have a question. There are some questions I'd like answered. What is the format for submitting those questions in advance so the parties could provide the information in time of the workshop?
Good question. How do we usually proceed on that, Mike?
This is a very unusual circumstance. I think if you just get them in any time, we'll immediately forward them to whoever Mr. Caracas designates.
Thank you.
Either himself or whomever.
So the focal person will be Mike?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Other questions, comments? Okay, yes, Councilor Groff.
Make a motion to adjourn.
It's been moved.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor McGinty. All those in favor? All right. Any again? Thank you very much.